They take that there.
Production center in Victoria.
1 minute.
In 2 minutes.
Techniques cassette decks, studio quality sound from all types of hi-fi tape, linear tracking turntables with distortion even lower than their profile, and revolutionary honeycomb speakers. Sonic purity you have to hear to believe. Hear all that's new from Techniques.
Hear the complete line of Technics equipment at Leader Sound, 450 Granville.
This week at IGA stores in BC, frozen whole frying chicken, utility grade, 99 cents a pound.
Your neighborhood IGA.
Coming up next, Webster.
Good morning. In this time of economic stress in British Columbia, our social credit masters in Victoria still managed to put away $1.3 million for the TV production center, much of whose duty is to coach politicians on how to behave on television. Brought up big shot Hollywood producer Norm Sedaway to prepare a script and prime time pointers for social credit politicians. These are information programs. We have a copy of the script. We are going to produce their script. What you see will be true and factual about the Sedaway script under the supervision of Doug Achilles Heel on how to operate as confident, calm social credit politicians under fire. So this morning I'm dropping out of my usual role, and we have assembled a vast cast of accomplished actors to mimic truthfully the script that you paid for. And I want to tell you right now, in Victoria, if there are any employees still there with all your vast expensive equipment around, immediately after the first commercial break, roll and record for posterity. Posterity, not for prosperity. And you can have this dub in this facility without any charge whatsoever. So, after the break, roll and record in Victoria, TV or not TV. That is the question.
Face the facts. Brought to you by the Social Credit TV Production Center in Victoria. Primetime training for politicians at the public's expense.
Hello. Hello. Welcome to Face the Facts. Our guest tonight is J. Spencer Jones, Executive Director of the School of Advanced Breathing. Good evening and welcome to the show, Mr. Jones.
Yes, Jones. I'm Jones. I'm pleased to be welcome to your show.
No, Mr. Jones. I'm much more interested in the recent comment by one of your executives. He said you were a hopeless administrator.
hopeless? Come on, really not that bad.
How bad are you, Mr. Jones? Shall we debate that?
No, but I have some statistics here. I'd like to read you. Two loaves of bread. No, that's not it. I did this kind of hurriedly this morning. Oh, here it is, 28%, I think it says.
28% of what, Mr. Jones?
I'm not sure. As I said, I was kind of rushed this morning, Mr. Fenton.
That's Denton, Mr. Jones. We are a little short of time, so thank you, Mr. Jones. Our next guest is...
But I just got started. My wife is videotaping this so I can see myself.
A very good idea, Mr. Jones. I hope you won't be too shocked, Mr. Jones. You do need help, Mr. Jones.
Help, yes, help. 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 Help.
TV or not TV? Coping with television appearances.
Television appearances are important. Learn to use television, not be used by television. The majority of people today look to television for the news. Print is far behind. And they form their opinions not so much by what they hear as by what they see. Right or wrong, style is more important than substance in television. First impressions are important, so let's begin with how you look. Let's start with wardrobe. Television does have some special needs. That's one obvious mistake. Don't you wish we could get rid of many politicians like that? Now, here's another mistake that too many men make, especially on television. Don't you always see their socks? That'd be the wrong way. Here comes the right way. Much more tasteful. Dress according to your position. Not too flashy, not too casual. Pause. Avoid vivid colors. Men look best in varying shades of grays, browns, or darker blues with pastel or off-white shirts and ties with subtle patterns. Said the laugh there. It's also a good idea to walk into the studio and check the set before the program so you can avoid chairs like that. Change page. To look your best on television means makeup, a dreaded word to many men, more understood by women, but necessary. Don't avoid it. Television needs it. Here, you can see the difference. Makeup absorbs light and flare and defines features. Should have turned over in the sun, Bob. In fact, it's so important that it's a good idea to learn enough about makeup to be able to apply it yourself. That way, you're prepared for those news mini cameras that are lurking outside your office.
Mr. Jones, would you come back here, please?
Oh, but do I have to? I made such a fool of myself last time.
Well, let's say you made some classic errors. First, you were very nervous. Confidence and control are key words.
Like this?
No. Not quite. Try to come across as Mr. Nice Guy.
Yes? What else?
Now, you were quite prepared to accept as fact that you were a somewhat hopeless administrator.
Well, should I have ignored the question?
No, but you made a very common mistake. You acted as if you had to answer. Social credit politicians don't have to answer. You don't, or you can turn it around by saying something like, I doubt that was said considering the degree of support I enjoy from my entire staff, and then launch into some very positive point in your favor. Just because you're asked a loaded question, there's no reason you have to answer it. Rephrase it.
Or say no comment.
No comment. No comment is not acceptable ever. Refuse to answer, but perhaps give your reason so that the viewer can sympathize.
But what if a host like Webster wants to talk about something I don't want to talk about?
Well, be prepared. The question you don't want asked will surely be asked. Television, after all, needs a spark to survive. So learn to bridge.
Oh, I play bridge.
No, not that kind of card game. The television game. Bridging takes you from where you are to where you want to go. It gives the interviewee, that's you, control, because it allows you to get into a topic or an angle that works best for you. Now, what's next? That works best for you. Watch interview shows like Meet the Press or Face the Nation or Issues or Answers and Jack Webster to see how it is done or not done. It's another skill that needs to be developed if you're going to use television to inform and advance your career. Let's go to the subject of body language.
Dirty language?
Body? No. B-O-D-Y language. So much of how you come across in television is often simple but meaningful body movements. For instance, Mr. Jones, when I mentioned about your failure as an administrator earlier, I saw you nodding your head. Well, when you nod your head in conversation at a cocktail party, that means, I understand, please go on. On television, nodding your head means that you agree with what is being said. Do not nod unless you're in agreement with what is being said.
But.
Not touching your host or another guest is a type of body language that suggests weakness. Okay. Folding your arms like that demonstrates a closed attitude. You are on guard and unwilling to listen. Watch your hand movements. Never cover your mouth, especially when talking. And don't pose just for the camera's sake. Don't do that. That's better now. Calmly. Very good. Body language is especially important when you are not talking but reacting. Reaction shots are a favorite of directors. They can be very useful or very destructive. After the Nixon-Kennedy debates, reaction shots were prohibited in presidential debates.
I watch the red lights on the camera, right?
Yes, but if the light goes out when you're talking to the lens, then don't do this.
Where is it?
Where is it? Cue director.
But you can do it this way. Look down, check out of the corner of your eye, and then turn to it as naturally as possible. It is useful sometimes to have a TV monitor off camera within easy range so that you can check what shots are being taken. But don't be distracted by it or sudden movements by crew members. Cameras that get too close can cause something like this. Don't play to the cameras that are behind you. Be aware that close-ups can see eye movement or the subtle touch of a raised eyebrow.
This is all certainly informative, you're supposed to say, Jones. But what about your crutch or your stall style?
Now I say,
Too many ahs, this is all in the script, and ums while you grope for an answer is a turnoff. Again, be prepared. Use short phrases that allow you time to think before answering.
But what do I do about nervousness? Have a drink?
Some talk shows have liquor available backstage for guests.
Surely not.
Stick with a coffee or a soft drink. A couple of drinks or a tranquilizer is not a good idea. The camera is very revealing. Besides, a little tension is good. Too much relaxation is a mistake. And Mr. Jones, your fly is open.
How's this?
Fine, except that your fly is still open. And you've got ink all over your shirt, you messy creature, and you don't listen. Do you, Mr. Jones? Do you listen?
Do what?
Listening is one of the single most important skills to use in dealing with television interviewers. Expect that verbal traps will be laid for you, especially when interviewers think you are off balance or not listening. You may be thinking of your response, but keep listening. Or you may be very sorry, and there's more. Are you likable?
I think so. My wife likes me.
Well, being likable on television is a major advantage to anyone. TV is not fair. TV is emotional. Charm and control are vital. Be nice. Be nicer than anyone else on the program, and you can't go wrong. Assuming you are reasonably articulate. Nice guys may not always finish first in business, but nice guys and gals always finish first on television. Now for a couple of elementary points. When you appear at the TV studio, know for whom to ask, what door to use, and be prompt.
Now, whether you're in a TV studio or in your dressing room, be aware of what you say. Microphones and recorders can be on as part of routine testing, and a casual or flip comment done in jest could come back to haunt you.
Don't be paranoid. Be sensible. Generally speaking, the technical crew will be helpful and understanding. Don't be afraid to ask for help or guidance. Okay.
Many people are upset by the seeming indifference of the crew. This is because, though it may be a major event for you, it is just more usual for them. Don't take their yawns or jokes personally. They're not laughing at you. Let's sum it up. Remember, first impressions are critical. Look good and feel good.
Show confidence and control. Humor is always better than anger.
Be prepared, know your topic, and use visual aids where you can.
Listen, listen, listen. Learn to think and listen.
Watch programs before you appear on them. Know as much as possible about your hosts and fellow guests.
Nervousness is normal. Expect it. No drinking or tranquilizers before the program.
Come across as pleasant, informal, the nice guy.
Expect tough questions. Know how to bridge the conversation into your best arena. Stand up for your rights even though you are lying down. Sitting down.
Smile. Relax. Be at ease. Learn to enjoy it. And we'll see you on television. We interrupt these closing credits to remind you of one last important tip. Even though the going may have been rough, how you conduct yourself during those last seconds can tell the audience a great deal. Smile, chat with your host, and generally communicate that you've had a stimulating exchange and look forward to your next get-together. Mr. Jones is still acting like he's in trouble. As a result, he is in trouble. Remember, Mr. Jones, confidence.
Face the facts. Brought to you by the Social Credit TV Production Center in Victoria. Prime time training for politicians at the public's expense.
A pretty strange way to start a week's programming, I don't mind telling you. And I don't know if it was funny or if it was not, but I want to thank my co-stars, Jimmy Hart, Noon News Jimmy Hart, prominent director in his spare time, and the ubiquitous Bob Ireland, who has one side of his face made up and the other. Thank you very much, gentlemen. There is no fee for this performance.
Drop over to our studio in Victoria. We'll help your show sometime.
Not a bad idea. Thanks very much, Jimmy. Thanks very much. Bob. Okay, now what I want to stress this morning is that that was the script for which British Columbia paid the Lord knows how many thousand dollars.
That's right.
The Sedaways wrote it. And he's a big Hollywood name,
big
can
Hollywood
you believe?
Producer, yeah.
And the budget for that script that you saw this morning is in this mass of documents supplied by the traitors in the TV production center through Charlie Barber. To be produced at a cost of just under $12,000. And how much did we have to cut out of the script?
We took out at least half of it. At least half of it.
And it's mostly repetitive garbage.
Oh, yes. How to smile correctly, how to wear makeup properly.
And we did we or did we not put in that offensive remark about your clothing?
Yes, we did, and I took that personally.
No, we didn't put it in.
No, this was in the script. All this
in
was verbatim
script.
In the script.
Mr. Jones, your fly is open. Right. How is that now? Right. Fine. Your fly is still open.
That's the usual problem of politicians not listening sometimes.
I wonder if we can get any calls on this. I wonder if we can stall long enough. I tell you what, if Lorne Parton is viewing this morning, although it's hardly for Lorne, maybe you could give us a critique on our acting. Or Peter Wilson, you know, the TV fellow in the Vancouver Sun. Or Leslie Wedman used to be a very perceptive and still is a perceptive film critic. We would like a rating. Personally, I thought you were awful.
Well, you know, you taught me everything I know, Jack. What can I say?
I was hot, uncomfortable. I tried to use the teleprompter, which my... can't read with my glasses on, and then I can't read my script with my glasses off, and here's the teleprompter up here. But we followed that, except for why I made one ad-lib crack. Which it was not.
Well, I missed my line at one point, but I on anyway, so it was fine.
Well, I don't know if we're going to raise any calls. My line at one point. Do you want to talk about our television performance this morning?
Well, I don't know if we're going to raise any calls.
Oh, that's obviously not a friend of mine. Are you there?
Hello.
Yes. What would you like to talk about, ma'am? Yes. Do hold on. I'll use you right away. How did you like our little script courtesy of your provincial government, TV or not TV?
Hello, Jack.
Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to tell you, Jack, that you as an actor are impossible. Why did you keep your face on us, the audience, rather than the person you were talking to? But anyway, I enjoyed it, and I'd like to have a lot of people watch it. I'm going
don't
to
blame
to
me. I don't switch
tonight.
The cameras. And to put down your television sound the next time you phone. Are you on the topic?
Yeah.
Go ahead, please.
I think you made an absolute ass of yourself.
I expected that. Thank you, ma'am. Next call, please. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, I thought that was a damn good little show you put on there. But I want to tell you something. I babysat for Norm Sedaway when he lived in Vancouver. He was just a little baby.
Was his fly open?
Huh?
Was his fly open?
No, it was a wee diaper.
Oh, I see, because he seemed to have a thing about flies. Go ahead, please.
Hello. I'd just like to give my rating for your acting.
Yes, please.
And I think that this is an example of what the government is doing. They've lost the next election.
It's only $1.3 million. Just $1.3 million.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's the budget for this department where they couldn't pay the bills and most of the contract workers were laid off. Probably lost a couple of votes, might have gained a couple of votes.
That's right.
After your performance.
I want to be an aspiring cabinet minister.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
It's Shirley McLaughlin, Liberal Party again.
Well, you must be happy this morning, Shirley.
Oh, yes. And I thought your performance was delightful. I even learned a little bit from it. But I'm sort of curious to know, did you cut out of the script any reference to women politicians, or is this all men with their flies open and don't like to wear makeup?
Oh, yes, we did cut out a lot about women, and that was the part about the jewelry bangling all over the microphone. You might remember that part.
Oh, yes, there was stuff about women, wasn't there?
And there was some mention of low-cut blouses as well.
Was there? Shirley, try to wear shell-type frames rather than metals. And if the glasses are aimed slightly towards the floor, you can avoid glare. That's what it says here. I don't see anything about low-cut dresses.
Yes, it's right just before.
Oh, yes.
There it is.
Women dress according to their occupation. There is a danger that a sexy outfit may be misunderstood by the audience.
You're kidding.
No, I'm not. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, you people seem to have a fixation with this TV thing. It reminds me that your Clem Chappell did this business a week or two ago from Victoria on this leak via Barber about this. I think it was McGeer's son retaped wedding or something.
No, McGeer's wedding was taped, but he didn't order it.
Right, and it wasn't until I saw it in the paper that I saw that after Chappell made it sound like it cost thousands, I think it was $13.
That was the tape.
Yeah, which of course didn't come across in Chappell's opinion
of things.
Part
well,
truth
if I were
is
you,
certainly what you dealt with in that
we dealt with
segment.
We dealt with the exact script. We didn't mention the $13. We told you the cost for this production scheduled was just under $12,000.
But you never told us on that Chappell business on the tape.
Didn't
he
do
made
the
it
Chappell
sound
business.
As though it was a huge deal and it was $13.
Make a complaint to Chappell. Oh, control.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Control, yes.
Calm, but a
dignity.
But a bit of tension is good.
Never answer a question. Style is more important than
absolutely.
Substance.
Absolutely. And listen.
Well, that woman's right. I am a pompous ass in these things. I mean, she is right.
What was your first clue?
That's not in the script.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead, please.
I was watching the script, and I think it was disgraceful and a waste of money. And I think Vancouver should get paid back.
Here, so do I. Much obliged.
Whatever happened the wrong way?
I don't know. Whatever did happen? Is there somebody there?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Send in that $12,000 about no smoking, no sweating, and take a remedial reading course.
Yeah, the sweating was bad this morning. Some idiot here put the heat up to 110, and it's not down yet. I don't know why they do it around this place. Everybody else is shivering, and I'm sweating. Did the heat ever go down?
No.
It's like a sauna bath in here this morning, and I feel like such a nit. Oh, I think we've had enough of that.
I think so.
Go do some work.
Why?
I'll give us a B minus.
B minus?
B minus.
Well, I still want to hear from Peter Wilson.
And Lorne Parton.
And Lorne Parton.
Okay. Back to business. What's business? Oh, yeah. Business this morning are two experienced aldermen from the city of Vancouver, Mae Brown and Marguerite Ford. About to give us a rating on Harcourt, Rankin, Davinsky, Puel, Bellamy, Boyce and Company. And to answer my simple question, is Vancouver City Council really falling apart, as it appears to be, after the break? Vancouver Magazine, please. A bit contrived, but I thought we had to do it.
Yeah. You're going to make us self-conscious of whether we're... Right? At least we don't have to worry about our flies being open.
Yes.
Imagine that being in the script.
Oh, isn't that crazy? We're supposed to look dignified.
It's in everything.
Can I have that magazine, please, Gladys?
No, I gave it.
I've been spending more time than for some time at Vancouver City Hall. And with that and the observations made by some experienced reporters like Sean Rossiter around the place, my own observations, I'm wondering what's going on. So I asked the two team members of council. I gravitate towards the easy, loud ones like Rankin and Erickson and York and Harcourt. So I decided to try and balance the views of Vancouver City Hall by bringing two women who don't seem to get involved terribly often in screaming matches at City Hall. May Brown, who once ran for mayor and was beaten. You've been on council how long altogether now, on and off?
4 years.
Total of 4 years. Mm-hmm. You had 2 years out.
Yes.
And then came back.
Yes.
And Marguerite Ford, how long have you been on council altogether now?
I've completed 5 years and this will be my sixth this year.
And this is an election year on council, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Does everybody come up for re-election?
Yes, the mayor and all the 10 aldermen.
Well, you're not given to extravagant statements, but I want to push you as hard as I can. Is there a crisis in Vancouver City Council in that it seems to be leaderless and without any firm policies on anything?
Well, I think the difficulty is that we have three groups on the council itself, so it's extremely difficult to get anything done and to get anything through City Hall. I think the council at the moment is given to debating at length on the small issues, and the big issues are being left unattended.
And whose fault is this?
Well, I suppose part of it would be the mayor, but a good deal of it's the council, because they do waste time. They get into endless wrangles.
Is it possible to run a city council or a city properly if you don't have a controlling group on council?
I don't think it's so much a question of control. It's a question of some kinds of consensus of what you're trying to get done, and this council doesn't have a consensus.
Julie Harcourt must carry a large share of the blame, though. I was in the other week, and it was an hour and a half on some stupid little reference of a subject back to a committee, and nobody could decide what committee it was going to go to.
That was really quite stupid.
Wasn't that quite funny that day?
Yeah, it was.
Council
terrible.
Wasn't always like that, was it?
Well, there have always been times when council was like that, but I think it's much worse now.
Now, are you going to run for mayor this year?
No.
You've made your one bite at it, and you're not going to run again.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So therefore, who's liable to be running for mayor this year, within your knowledge, ladies?
Harcourt, as far as I know, intends to, and there are rumors of various people that are interested. We haven't, as team, made a decision on whether we will run a mayoralty candidate or not.
That was Zlotnick the last time, wasn't it?
He ran the last time, yeah.
Yeah. Zlotnick, how about John Reynolds? Have you heard anything about that man Reynolds running?
We have heard that he intends to seek the NPA nomination.
He wouldn't seek the team nomination.
No, I don't believe he would.
But how about Jack Volrich? He seems to be getting ready to run too, doesn't he?
We understand that from reports in the newspaper.
All right, now let's come to issues. How important is this Shaughnessy kerfuffle, which seems to have the city council in complete bewilderment? Who's going to answer that question?
Well, as the issues go, it isn't a very important issue, but it seems to be affecting a lot of people, and there are very strong pros in favor of controlling the traffic through Shaughnessy, and there are, of course, very strong antis who are getting organized.
Where do you stand on it?
Well, I'm very much in favor of controlling traffic in residential streets. I don't think we have necessarily found the solution to it in these barriers, because it seems to have caused almost as many problems as it has solved.
It looks to me like a snob move to protect a fancy little group of wealthy residents in that
exclusive part of Shaughnessy.
No,
we've done this in many parts of the city. We did it in Shaughnessy and in Strathcona in the early days.
But that was a new development, Strathcona.
Yes, and I think, really, if you were building Shaughnessy today, you'd probably put in some sort of cul-de-sacs or something. But as far as most members of council, Jack, we're not dealing with it as a major issue. We're certainly listening to the people, and in due course it will come back to council. We have many, many big issues at council.
But you put them in the West End for two reasons. For one reason, that was to try and control the traffic of the prostitutes. Is that not so?
Yes, we did. Mm-hmm. But we did.
Surely they don't have that kind of traffic in Shaughnessy.
No, but we did put them west of Denman in the West End to keep the commuter traffic out, and they've been very successful.
So how long will the barriers stay for a minimum now in Shaughnessy just to dispose of that?
Well, we put them in as a trial, and we're giving the engineers enough time to collect the data on what other improvements are needed in the traffic system in the area. My guess is another month or two before we get that report back.
And they may stay or they may come out?
Depending on what the results are that that we get, and obviously there will be some changes because we've already identified some problems where people are cutting through lanes, which, you know, is not a solution to the problem.
Now, you're the chairman of the finance committee, are
yes,
you not?
Yes.
How are the city's finances?
Well, I think, on the whole, the city's in good financial shape. Vancouver has a history of good financial management. We have excellent staff in our finance department, and I think we are in good shape.
What about the assessments this year and the school mill rates?
Well, that is a crisis. No doubt about that, because if the assessments in Vancouver go up drastically, as far as our general purpose situation is concerned, we can lower the mill rate and adjust the mill rate and the business tax. In the school division, we have no control. The province sets the mill rate, and if our assessments are extraordinarily high in comparison to the rest of the province, then we pay a greater proportion of the school budget, and that is not fair.
Well, let me get this quite clear. On general purpose assessment, you raise the money needed to run the city.
That's correct.
On school assessments, you raise what you're told to raise.
They levy a mill rate against the assessments that we have.
And what happens to the $11 million surplus somebody was talking about on the school?
That is not a correct statement in general. We will be raising, by the assessments we have in Vancouver and the mill rate already set, $11 million in excess of the basic education program. Now, to say that will be sent to Victoria isn't quite correct, because the Department of Education sends back $17 million for other purposes. So yes, if you took just the basic education program on which the whole province participates to give everyone equity in education, then we will raise $11.5 million in Vancouver in excess of what it takes to run the Vancouver educational system.
Is it not right, therefore, to say that that's $11 million surplus, which perhaps properly is divided between among the poorer school districts?
That's what's going to happen. But just to say we send it to Victoria isn't correct, because they send it back. I think it's grossly unfair, and I think we have to do something about it, and we're tending to try to urge them in this region where we have these tremendous increases in our assessment to lower the mill rate.
But then again, you've got no control over what the school board wants to do.
Not at all.
With its additionals over the basic.
And one of the problems with this formula is it gives a good excuse for the school board not to control their budget at all, because they can say, oh, well, it's the formula. And so their budget has gone, I mean, every year it goes up, and this year it's gone up quite a lot, and the number of children have gone down markedly. But they can say it's all the province's fault.
Which political group runs the school board?
At the moment, the majority is COPE.
COPE. Mm-hmm. So COPE now has control of the school board?
That's right.
TEAM has control of nothing?
No, we just have the two elected aldermen.
More with May Brown and Marguerite Ford, the TEAM alderman and council, and your questions and other issues after the break. Okay, now let's just run down some issues. The roads to the stadium. What is the score on the roads to the stadium? Mind you, I think people will go there if there are no roads.
That's right.
But what's the score, Marguerite?
Well, we're working towards a reasonable set of roads for the stadium. I mean, obviously there have to be some roads, but what we want is a minimum amount of road that will serve the stadium and the future development without developing freeways that are going to put massive traffic into residential areas that are adjusted.
But that can be, Street Bridge has got to go.
Well, we have a program to replace the North End.
North End?
The North End, yes. We don't have the budget for the total project.
In other words, you'd replace it up to the swing span?
Yes, just about that far. Yeah. And it's fairly a big project. We're hoping for cost sharing with BC Place, and I think that might come about.
but hoping for might come.
No, well, we have a program. No. We've the consultants. We've let a contract to the consultants.
There's
it's being planned, and we intend to have that.
So the northern approaches be done in time for the opening of the stadium.
Well, they'll certainly be well on the way. The consultants have been hired. The reports will be back. We're working on the funding, and that's underway.
All right. How much do you resent the extra provincial powers that BC Place has as they carry on with this vast and as yet unspecified development?
Well, I think the council, the previous council, made an error by saying, you know, go ahead and don't worry, fast track it and don't worry about our development permit process. That's a mistake. I don't think should deal that way. Fortunately, in previous instances, the provincial government has abided by our zoning, and hopefully they will now.
But they don't have to.
They don't actually have to, no.
I mean, NAROD can really do what it likes
in
that project.
Absolutely.
Well, they've got the best of both worlds because they say we're government, so we don't have to pay any attention to you, and we're private enterprise, so we don't have to provide any social housing. So we're fighting them on both of those things.
But
what we agreed to was a cooperative planning process. Up until now, it hasn't been terribly cooperative.
But surely as good right-wing teamers, I mean, as distinct from York, Erickson, Harcourt, and Old Loudmouth, what's his name? Rankin. Surely as distinct from them, you must realize that NAROD and company are not going to put social housing in there.
Oh, well, I wouldn't agree with that. I think that we're going to have mixed housing. I think the example that was shown on the south side of Falls Creek as a development community, I think everyone has realized the success
lovely.
Of that.
Great success.
But what they've said, Jack, is that they will use the programs that now exist, and that's what we have to get at. We have to be sure that the programs are there so that a variety of housing can go in.
And Bennett has obviously told NAROD and company that you've got to balance the books in this BC place.
Yes, but they have a tremendous asset there in that land. They struck a good deal.
But they're going to put up fancy, wealthy, incredible penthouses for the rich in the north side.
I wouldn't totally agree, because there's got to be a variety of housing. We say we're building housing there for people that work in the downtown. Now, all kinds of people work in the downtown. It'd be quite foolhardy to put all executive housing when you want people to be able to walk to work in the downtown. I think we're fighting for mixed housing, and I think we'll get it.
And
I'm very optimistic.
You think we'll get it?
Well, I think the market will help us, because they couldn't be able to sell at that price that much expensive housing. They really have to spread their market.
It's going to be a very expensive building there, and they're going to have to go up awfully high.
Well, no, I don't totally agree. If you take the cost of the price they paid for the land, it's expensive now, and therefore the commercial buildings naturally will be, you know, top flight. But if you take the amount they paid for the land, and once they've put in their capital for the development up front, then I think you could get a mixed development. We did on the south side.
Okay, next question on ALRT. Are you as alderman prepared to vote the money to put it underground and commercial or anywhere else?
Well, we voted against the tunnel.
You did?
Yes. The majority of council, a majority, voted for a tunnel. And the mayor had asked me to chair a committee to negotiate to see what we could come up with the provincial government. We're in the process of those negotiations. Clearly, if we can get a good deal, council wants a tunnel. If it's going to be very, very costly for the city of Vancouver, I would find that that would be very difficult to support.
There have been some insinuations that somebody stands to make a lot of money by the location of the station down on Tamil Avenue. I forget the name of the people that bought it. I'd use it, but there have been insinuations. Do you think there's been any that insinuations should be made about personal profit on train stations?
Not a bit. That property was on the market. That piece of property was for sale. Everyone saw the sign on it. The city properties division, through our property endowment fund, was well aware that that property was for sale. The city owns the property on the south side of Terminal. And when it came to council to make a decision about the location of the station, clearly our top priority was to decide what was the best location for a station with the alignment. And we chose the north side because of the alignment.
Right.
Now, certainly, we've always said anybody that profits from the ALRT should help to pay something, and it's quite appropriate then to try to strike some sort of an arrangement with the owners of that property so that they don't just get a clear advantage. But the property on the south side will enhance in value also, and that's city property.
I think it's also, when that property was sold, the plan was to have the ALRT station in the middle of the street, which is a matter of feet from that property. And it would have been a profitable development if a development goes there in any case, whether the station is in the building or beside it.
When will we ride the ALRT, just as a rough guess?
January the 1st, 1986. I'm confident it will be built.
You sure?
Well, I certainly hope so. That's the
plan. Yes,
I do. Oh, yes, I do. I think it's well underway. I think it's being well handled. And the contracts are going to be let, many of them at the same time. And I'm confident it'll be built.
More with Mae Brown and your calls, too, and Marguerite Ford after the break. The other day when we were up at the City Hall and there was a fire alarm, we're gossiping now. I like to gossip. I knew that Rankin would be mad at what Sean Rossiter said about him in Vancouver magazine. So I got the two together, and I thought they were going to come to blows.
Well, the air was rather hot.
I'm blue.
I moved away because the language from Rankin was so bad, I couldn't stand it.
You know what he says about Harry this week in Vancouver magazine? He says, this is Rossiter about Rankin. The senior alderman has become an institution, earned the right to lapse periodically into self-pity, to ramble incoherently and indulge, as he always has, in vicious personal insults. It must gall him, says Rossiter of Rankin, to knuckle under, as always, to Mayor Harcourt, whom he considers his inferior. When you see Harry today and tomorrow, would you ask him if he's read Vancouver magazine?
I'll do that.
Will you ask him?
No, I won't. He'll curse me out if I ask him that.
What do you think of Harry? Do you think he's just become too loud and long-winded?
Well, he certainly is too long-winded in council for getting the work done. There's no doubt about that. I think Harry talks the most and at the greatest length of anyone.
Who causes the most trouble in council? Right. I mean, all these delays and whatnot.
Well, I think Alderman Rankin is largely to blame because he takes issue on a very small item, and that delays council because then a wrangle ensues. Mm-hmm. And I think what we have to do is try to get people to realize that we won't, if we're going to be discussing the major issues at 11 o'clock at night, then we have to get on with the important
issues. What about Davinsky, though? He strikes me as a bit clueless when I watch him in council.
Well, his odd remarks are a bit out of place, but he doesn't delay council because he doesn't speak at length the way Rankin does.
How about what is described by Rossiter as the three NPA hacks, Boyce, Kennedy, and Puel? Are they hacks in your view, NPA hacks?
Well, I would never call anyone hacks, but...
This guy gets it himself. Would you call them hacks?
I don't think it's my job to rate other aldermen. My job is to get the work done if I can, and I really am
prepared to rate Harcourt.
Well, I can give an opinion.
Where does he stand as mayor?
I think he's a pretty good mayor. I think his problem is that he's a consensus worker. He's trying to run council in the way that Art Phillips did. Spread the work around and give everybody a chance and get an opinion as a group. Well, he hasn't got that kind of council. And he turns around and looks for people to do things, to carry the ball, and he looks at May and I, and he gives us one more job. He just hasn't got the level of ability that Art Phillips had in his first council.
But you can't really blame him, because he's got this number of MPA, two team, and the three co people.
Yes.
Everybody's out not to cooperate.
He has a very difficult situation, and being an independent himself, he doesn't really have a group of people to move things through council.
All right, election this November, isn't it? It's not in the
November.
Ward system, can it be in place?
Well, our officials tell us it can be in place if it passes the legislature in Victoria by, say, June.
Are you for or against?
Yes, I'm for a ward system.
What kind of ward system?
Well, I think just a simple, straightforward, divide the city into 10 or 12 areas, clearly defined with clear boundaries, and I think you would find that the people could relate much better to our civic election.
No alderman at large?
Well, we, for years, believed in that philosophy, but we found that when it went to council, we didn't get the support, and that the commission, they wouldn't back the Eckhart Commission on it, so you can't push a position endlessly.
Okay, you two are agreed on this.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm very committed to a vote. When you ask the people something and they tell you, then I think you've made a commitment.
All right, now, who has been dragging his feet on the establishment and the work of the committee which is handling wards?
Well, we're doing right now what could have been done a year ago. Alderman Rankin was appointed to chair a committee last January. The mayor asked him to take this committee and to so that we could get the boundaries defined and so forth. Nothing was done.
By Rankin,
nothing.
For a year,
we had one meeting in the summer and nothing came of it. And then we put a motion in the fall that said, we do have a lot of information within the officials at City Hall. Give us the statistical information and let us go to the people with to see what they say about the boundaries.
It's a fairly technical thing to draw board boundaries that have the you know,
but
an equal
Rankin
number of
But Rankin dragged his feet for
Absolutely.
A long time.
Yes.
Why?
One year.
Is he afraid of the ward system now?
It looks as though they might be.
You mean that they might not elect Erickson, Bruce, Cope, Swanson?
I don't think they will do well on the ward system.
Funny, I thought they would.
No, I don't believe so, because people tend, if they have 10 votes, to sort of think through and get a variety. If they have one vote, they're going to vote for the person they think will work for them.
If I dare speak to Harry again after quoting Rossiter this morning, I must ask him if he's chickening out on the ward system. Does it look like that to you?
Well, he certainly was given the mandate to go ahead and draw up the boundaries and take it to the people, and
okay.
It didn't happen.
Next question. Are you sorry that Grace has gone down the tube with the convention center?
Well, as it was structured and the administrative structure we had and the financing, I'm not sorry that we have delayed it, because I feel that postponed indefinitely, whatever the term is, because I feel that the finances were not worked out. The city, however, in the final analysis was out of it and had said we'll put our $8 million. So we
but
were not involved
it's
in
it. It's a
the
big
end.
Blow to the economy of the tourist trade, surely.
Well, I think it's a tragedy, because it was a good idea and we should either have got competent management, and, you know, Alderman Fuel and Mayor Volrich at the time had absolute majority in council and an absolute majority on PRBC board. They should have got on with it, decided either build it or abandon it and get another one going in time. I mean, to wait, to take the amount of time that they took to get where we are now is just disgraceful.
I probably missed some major issues. Any other major issues?
Well,
transit,
traffic is traffic is an issue. You touched on with the Shaughnessy barriers, but it is
that's just
an
a joke
issue.
To me.
But
I think the other issue in this city is this whole question of zoning and density. Are we going to continue with the city at large, with the level of population we have, which most people enjoy, and they do enjoy their neighborhoods and they enjoy the type of life they are leading. And yet on the other hand, we find that people are saying we need housing, we need, you know, more space, we need more economical housing. Now these are some of the broad issues that are hard to come to grips with, but we in Vancouver must face up to it. It's the whole question of density in the downtown. Do we want to continue to have, you know, a large number of office buildings continuing to be built? We have tremendous zoning downtown.
Yeah,
those are some
problem.
Of the big issues. How much do you want Vancouver to change?
Looking back on it, one of my favorite nostalgic hobby horses, what is another fact that the worst decision ever made in this city was to put these shopping centers underground?
I think so. I never go near them. I think
Vancouver doesn't need underground.
That was Rathi, Campbell, and Phillips. All involved in that development.
Yes, they were. Mm-hmm.
And here we are with all these thugs on Granville Street, all the prostitute problems because there are no people around because they're down below. Mm-hmm. It's a shame, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. But it certainly made it very difficult for the merchants on Granville Street to make a living. And
your questions to Marguerite Ford of Team and Mae Brown of Team on Civic Affairs after the break. Okay, haven't gone to the phones on City Hall matters for a long time, certainly with you two women. I shall have a demand for equal time next week from York, Erickson, Rankin. I asked Puel to come, but he can't come because he's school teacher.
Yes, that's right. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, good morning.
Morning.
I'd like to say that, first of all, that I don't think it's fair to lay all the blame for the present council at the feet of Mayor Mike Harcourt. I realize he has a difficult problem there, but I'm sure that he'll pull through in the next election. Point I'd like to comment on is the ward system and the whole lower mainland area, which I think should be under a ward system. And by that I mean municipalities like Port Coquitlam, Coquitlam, Port Moody, Burnaby, New Westminster.
One big city?
That's right. And I think by doing that, we could get better planning, residential planning and density planning, because that is all interrelated with the traffic and ALRT and the
good
whole
question.
I don't think we're going to see any type of rational planning on a...
You may be right, and we've got two people who know a fair bit about it. May.
Well, we do have almost a ward system, you might say, with the Greater Vancouver Regional District. And they have certain functions that they carry out and do it well. And I think we certainly support the regional district. I'm on the board. And you're quite right, as far as things like transit are concerned, you have to deal with the region. You can't have something that stops in New Westminster or Vancouver.
Yes, but the GVRD does not really have any authority in Burnaby. For example, if Burnaby wanted to go and develop an area of its own, and it didn't correspond to the regional district's planning department, they can go ahead and do it. What I'm saying is that the autonomy is not
just
there.
Just a minute.
Yeah, no, you're wrong in that, because there is the official regional plan, and within the broad concept, such as if it's zoned as urban, then Burnaby has the right to develop along that way, or to plan along that way, but they can't go against the official regional plan. There is a broad plan for the whole area that the regional district at the moment is the administrator
of. What this chap would like to see is amalgamation. And yes. I don't suppose anyone talks about that anymore.
No,
I'd like to see that.
We don't, and certain functions, I agree with this, what this gentleman's saying. There are certain functions which I think should be considered. We have you know, water and sewage and drainage and
all
hospitals.
Really don't matter when it comes to
the
neighborhoods. And
transit, though. Transit is, and the road network is a regional thing. But I agree with you. We should examine some of the other functions. We might even examine, you know, fire and police and some of those things on a more regional basis.
Thank you, sir. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning.
Morning.
I think Alderman Brown mentioned that traffic is one of the major issues of the city. And I would like a discussion more on the traffic problem that the new stadium is going to occur. Question is that, has there been any discussion at all on the feasibility of possibly a mass parking situation outside of the city limits, with a people mover transportation into the stadium, and just general traffic conditions in the downtown area, because everybody knows that
hold
they
are breath.
Really atrocious. I would like that talked about, please.
Okay, would you talk about it, please?
This is one of the major concerns
Thank
of this
you.
Whole discussion on the roads, and one of the reasons that City Council was very unwilling to simply approve the road system without looking at a lot of that. There has got to be a park and ride system. I'm pushing very strongly for a system whereby the purchaser of a ticket to a stadium event actually gets a bus ticket, which he may or may not use, but at least there'll be an incentive to use buses. But you're right, we have to organize that as a park and ride and have the areas designated.
Silly
it has
question.
To be organized.
Is it a station at the stadium?
Oh, yes.
Yes. But we should mention that already there is, for this gentleman's information, there is already a committee set up called the Management, Traffic Management Committee, and it's tied in with another committee which is called the Stadium Scheduling Committee. Mm-hmm. And you have to coordinate all these functions. You have to coordinate, as you say, park and ride. Now you have to go to the MTOC and say, we're going to need X number of buses. Then you have to be able to arrange that with the people selling the ticket to either pay with the ticket to park your car out in wherever. So there's a fairly highly technical group together now called a traffic management group for the stadium with the stadium scheduling group.
But there is lots of parking at night downtown.
And that's what they'll be doing. They'll be finding where the big parking lots are, and they'll be able to say there are 500 parking stalls in this building, and they'll have to book those and tie it in with the tickets they sell to the stadium, and book people into those 500 stalls.
You think that's really necessary?
Well, in the major parking, public parking, in the ones that belong to office buildings, you'll just leave it to the people. A lot of people have their own parking in their buildings, and they'll use their parking.
And some of the buildings don't have their parking open at night. It could be open.
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, as an old cab driver, and I mean old, I'd like to say that anything that impedes traffic in Vancouver, in a city as congested as Vancouver, is almost criminal. And I'd like to just make a couple of observations. At the corner of Broughton and Nelson, there's a four-way stop. Right behind the stop sign, going north and south, is a chain, a barrier. So there's absolutely no reason for the four-way stop there because there's no traffic can go north or south. Mm-hmm. One block further west, there is a fire station at the corner of Nicola and mm-hmm. Nelson. If there's a fire south of Davy Street, the fire engines have got to go up to Jervis to get to Davy or down to Denman to get to Davy, both streets being horribly congested at all times.
And well, it's a big city now, you know. You can't expect freeways just going smooth, mm-hmm. smooth, smooth, mm-hmm. smooth. Mm-hmm. I mean, go to San Francisco, or New York, or London. We're still only a small town.
That's right.
Aren't we?
Well, and the gentleman is correct that because we've put in these temporary chains, because that was to try to stop the car circling for the prostitutes, we haven't actually implemented the total plan. So you do, he's quite right, you do get situations now where you've got stop signs mixed up with chains. Yeah. That won't be when the total plan is put
in place. Thank you very much. And of course, the prostitutes will vanish with the wave of a wand one day when these idiots in Ottawa finally pass a decent amendment to the criminal code after the break. May Brown, team, Vancouver Alderman, Marguerite Ford, the two solitary team women on council. Another piece of gossip. I'm not supposed to tell you this, but I'm going to tell you anyway. Helen Boyce asked for a seat to be moved. She was sitting between, who was she sitting between?
Puel and Erickson.
Puel and Erickson. However, Helen has changed her mind about asking a seat to be moved. You know, it must be very difficult in that council because Helen's a very nice person, you know. Mm-hmm. Talks an awful lot, but she's really having quite a bad time on council.
The men are kind of mean to her.
They are kind of
nasty
mean
to her, yeah.
Some of them are quite rude.
Very.
No names, no pipe drill.
Yeah.
There's Puel and there's Rankin. York is quite gentlemanly, isn't he?
He's not nasty in council, that's quite true.
Go ahead, please. Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
Yeah, when light rapid transit comes in, who's going to get to run it, the Metro service or the BC Hydro?
Well, BC Hydro isn't involved at the moment with our transit bus system. We have the Metro Transit Operating Company.
Metoc, we call it.
Yeah, that's on contract, that does carries out the service for the GVRD. The GVRD signs the contract, and they hire Metro Canada to carry out the system.
Yeah, now, but the LRT is going to be running on the existing Hydro lines.
Yes, and that will be quite different, and there are talks underway already as to you know, who will handle it. We'll have unions involved, we'll have a whole discussion, and that already is underway as to who actually will be undertaking the operation, but right. Nothing has been settled.
Hydro, Metoc, GVRD, what about Utah?
Well, they're the all-over provincial body that has to do with funding, and the GVRD signs a contract with them because they put up the provincial money. It's complicated.
You could make a good case for a benign dictatorship. Yes.
On transit, you could. You could, and we might do a better job if we had one.
We have a four-headed monster now on transit.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, yes, can you clarify something for me? Is that BC Place or the stadium going to go through? Are you saying that the work has stopped on it because they're still climbing all over there like ants?
Oh, no.
Convention Center is down the tube. That's the waterfront gimmick is gone.
Oh, I see.
The stadium will be scheduled on time, and BC Place is going ahead as far as we are told.
Well, BC Place is a very large development project of about 175 acres, and that area will be developed over a period of 15 years. That's a big redevelopment of the north side of Falls Creek, so it's not just one.
I'm concerned because I'm on Canby Street, and the traffic here is atrocious.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to get much worse, I can imagine, now with having that, it is a main street, but
yes.
With having the stadium down there, how in God they're going to get that, looking at it. You know, and I'm right across there all the time. How
we'll manage, won't we?
Well, the idea is to
The traffic enormously on Canby.
We have to discourage people bringing cars, and that's one of our concerns. If there isn't a decent system for scheduling stadium events, we're going to have 60,000 people trying to get into 2,000 parking places, and it will be a disaster. So
and
it really
tell you
has
another
to
thing
be managed.
About these underground parkings, or even the parking lots, a lot of these people that do have parking wouldn't want to take the responsibility, because if cars are left parked on parking lots, such as Safeways or whatever, and they happen to get damaged, people have been known to sue these places.
Oh, no, that's no problem.
Well, they will make a financial arrangement, though, for the parking lots.
But BC Place itself, looking at it overall, surely must be a good concept.
Oh, I think
it has
is.
Tremendous potential.
Oh, yes.
It can be a very good thing, as the south side of Falls Creek was
a good
thing.
You know, we do have land, 175 acres, in the heart of an urban area, and it isn't well used at the moment, and they're taking out the rail lines, so obviously it's going to be redeveloped. And
no social credit to he, but I don't think the city would ever have done anything on that scale.
No, because we don't own it. We wouldn't be able to afford to buy it, and the city isn't into that type of major development. On the south side, we owned land, and we assembled land to make a total package.
And it's been a great success.
And a big success, yes.
Go ahead, please. Hello there. Oh, nobody there, Glad.
Hello.
Your ma'am, speak up, please.
Hello.
Hello.
Alderman May Brown.
Yes.
Referring earlier this morning, I'm quite interested, in the downtown area of Vancouver, you commented briefly on, to put it not exactly in your words, are we going to continue to build these large office towers? For instance, now that the Devonshire Hotel has gone, and I've heard that the Ritz, may mm-hmm. go to the Rutgers Ball, that, in other words...
Yes, you're correct.
Some of us are wondering, right in the heart of the downtown, where people, get off buses, and mm-hmm. people meet, have a cup of coffee, and also shop. But,
and what's your question?
Not much left. With one thing after the other, going to the records.
Okay, she's raised your point about how many office buildings
yes.
you build
there. Well, of course, you have at the Devonshire Hotel, that's redevelopment. The Bank of BC is building there.
Huge thing.
A big, big mm-hmm. project. And we've heard that the Ritz Hotel may be redeveloped, that
yeah,
area.
See, redevelopment
but I think I haven't heard
it.
Much about that lately.
No.
But that is redevelopment. Now, the point is that if someone owns a piece of land and there's a certain zoning on it, then they are being allowed to build to that density. The question I think we have to ask ourselves, we collectively, this community, is do we want to continue with that amount of density in a very restricted downtown area? And if we do, then we are going to get very large buildings because the density in the downtown. Now, TEAM as an organization in the Art Phillips era, we tended to say that some in the West End and some places we should downzone. It was too much density. At the moment, I think we have to look at a broader area, which is the whole city. We don't have high density in the residential areas.
I don't know how you downzone it if the city continues to grow. Do you, Marguerite?
Well, it's extremely difficult.
The old free enterprise clause out. You can't
yes.
downzone
well,
me.
Yes.
You can't
right. well, that's the problem,
downzone the guy next
yes.
door.
And that's the problem, you see. And here's BC Place suggesting that they would add 7 million square feet of office space to what we think is probably too much office space. face potential in the downtown already, and they're saying, well, give it to us and take it away from the other guy. And I don't really think we can do that.
But the point is, if other areas, if Burnaby with their metro center and some of these other areas and some of the sub areas in Vancouver become attractive, mm-hmm. then you're going to deflect development to those areas. So we, in the whole residential area of Vancouver, 75% of our residential land is still single family home. And we appreciate that, and people like that, and I think, therefore, we're at the decision-making time.
It's a big decision.
It's a big decision.
God knows who's going to make it.
And those single family homes are too expensive for young families to buy now, too, so that's, we're finding the young families are going out to Surrey.
More with Ford, Brown, and Webster after the break. Go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. Good morning. May I speak to Alderman Brown?
Please do.
Yes.
At the first there, you were saying that the city council had sort of stalled or got into a rut. What did you say was the fault? Was that?
Well, it seems to me that we deal with in council with very small issues and take, you know, an hour dealing with a small issue when I think we should be taking the very big issues that we have in front of us and exploring them in depth and having a very good debate and getting all the points out.
But what I was going to suggest was this. Hello?
Yes.
What I was going to suggest was this. We have, as you say, a three-part system in the city council. And the problem there, we have the COPE, which are very argumentative. I don't think they want anything done. Socialism is that way. They like to argue and get nothing done. But the more confusion that they bring forth, the better they think they show people that they are the ones that should be in.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I think this is what the problem in there.
How about the NPA?
NPA? Mm. Well, we have different people there with ideas.
Mm-hmm. Where?
At least we'd have had a lot of the economy going in Vancouver. Whether it was NPA or what's the other one there?
Team.
Team, yes. I think team. They both are a lot, they are more
anyway,
together in a lot of the...
You'll carry on forever. Let me say that. I think everybody has some sympathy with Harcourt, although he's a poor chairman of a meeting. He's got no cohesive group whom he can caucus with and direct his plans to go his way.
That is part of the problem.
Our court's the same as all of them.
You mean another old do-gooder NDP-er?
Well.
Okay, fine. I don't need to drag insults out of callers. That's not really fair, because Our court's a very nice guy.
Very nice.
Mm-hmm. Kind to his wife and kids. Go ahead, please.
Yes, you know, I'm phoning God knows about our conventions, that enough has been said. But you know, $300 million worth of people coming here, new money into this province, and the jobs when we need them coming in. And here these two people, the people were so much against that when jobs in this province are needed and a convention center is needed, and it was on the way, and now it'll be years and years and years. We'll never see a convention center. I just think it's a bunch of stalling by these people, two people who have it on their program. Most people are in favor of that convention center, but these two have been continually against it. And God, we need these jobs now.
Okay,
well,
very good call, sir.
But that is incorrect.
How do you plead, though?
No, we supported the convention center. We voted for the $5 million. We said that if the city kept to its conditions that it started with, that it would be a good deal. We supported the idea that there should be cooperative planning between the CPR, Marathon, Project 200, and the provincial and federal governments for the cruise ship. We supported that all through 1978 when the opportunity was there to set that thing up properly. They had our full support. When they lost our support for the way it was being done was the fact that then the city began to get dragged into an arrangement that was not a good financial arrangement, And clearly, the people that had control of City Hall with a majority did not get on and do the thing properly.
But surely it was Bill Bennett who finally chopped it.
Oh, I think when the finances got completely out of control, yes, I don't think he had a choice. They obviously weren't going to get it done, and certainly not within any kind of budget.
But can't you two be blamed for foot dragging and causing some of the complications throughout these months and months?
Not on council for 2 years when the thing was going to be going through. We had one alderman.
Let's blame Marguerite then.
We had one that much power. Jack Balridge had an absolute majority on that council for 2 years. He and Alderman Puel had a majority on the PRBC. They must have. If it was ever workable, why didn't they do it?
If it was workable.
I think the finances became much too complicated.
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
That's you, sir.
Yes. As a relative newcomer to Vancouver, I'm curious to know whether there's ever been an effort made to move into a metro system such as Toronto or Winnipeg. That's my question.
When did you come? Yesterday?
No, about 7 years ago.
Oh. Well, we do have, as I mentioned previously, we have the Greater Vancouver Regional District, which is a federation of the municipalities. The metro system has been studied here. It has never got much support. The regional district carries out certain functions and has historically done a number of things and done them well. They've taken on more functions recently. Hospitals was fairly recent, now transit. And I think it's to go that way and prove the system, and then it will get support, in my view.
But we're heading towards a metro transit single authority one of these
days.
As far as
transit, my feeling is we could go to that almost any time.
Go ahead, please.
Oh, good morning. Me?
Yes, you, sir.
Yes, I would like to know why our city council cannot direct our police force to take some sort of different action against these prostitutes in the West End. Obviously, because of the federal laws where they are, they cannot get the prostitutes off the street. The barriers really aren't working that well. Instead of harassing the prostitutes, because all it is an inconvenience to a prostitute to be hauled down, booked, and then have the charge thrown out, why not go after the customers? If you get rid of the customers, I mean, some gentleman driving around there, I'm sure, does not want to be taken down.
Sam, you've opened up a whole
soliciting and then brought back.
Just to say, that's exactly what I think the solution would be, and there isn't any way we've been able to persuade the federal government that we can do it. We just are not allowed to do that.
In fact, Marguerite, you can charge customers to some extent, but the police don't want to do it, the courts don't want to handle it. Nobody wants to face up to it. We do need an amendment to the criminal code.
That's right. One was taken to court, and for some reason or another was not taken to the Supreme Court. In spite of the fact, City Council asked the Attorney General to appeal that one.
That was where the case was.
Webster?
Yes, carry on.
Just to be facetious, it occurs to me that it could be that they may find, catch too many good citizens in their net, as they have with a couple of local justices.
Well, no, that's not, to be quite honest, it's a good snide remark, but it's not applicable as such. It's a social problem that won't go away, and for the sake of the good, decent citizens, they don't want to see the city covered with a bunch of hookers.
Well, if we could discourage
the customers,
then possibly
the hookers
would move on somewhere
else. And you've got to get some way to break them up and get them off the street from time to time.
Yes, but the gentleman has a very good point, you know. Everything that we bring in and talk about legislation, we go after the women, the prostitutes. And clearly the customers are at fault. And if we could, and this is why we supported the idea even of the diverters, at least you stop them from driving around and around, you make it a little more inconvenient. But clearly we must get at the person who it is the customer, just as much as the person who's the prostitute.
From a practical point of view, you can't do it, unfortunately.
I mean, no, at the moment, we haven't found a way, I must confess.
And you know perfectly well, in today's society, that's an interference with the liberty of the prostitute, far less the hooker.
But isn't it interesting,
the other one.
Jack, we used to say that, in my youth, well, it's our repressive Victorian morals that are causing rape and prostitution. All we have to do is just liberalize everything and it'll all go away. But it suddenly got all
worse. And when you read these charges about the Senator Hotel, but you've got to be practical. These kind of things will go on in the Senator Hotel, as they used to go on in the women's unit or the Carla when you had men. It's very difficult to avoid it. I don't know what you do.
Yes.
But you got to keep the streets clean. You got to get these 16-year-old kids with venereal disease.
Well, we're certainly prepared.
Getting the customer will be a number one way to do that.
Of course it would.
And we're certainly prepared to work just as hard as we can to try to solve this problem. I think the Senator Hotel project is one step. It has to be carefully scrutinized, but it's a step. I still think the barriers are not a bad idea, and it's something worth trying. But if you don't keep trying something, you're just sitting back and letting it get worse.
I don't know the answers.
No.
Well, the police commission, of course, is the body that directs our police force, and they are very concerned, and the mayor has worked hard for this amendment.
Well, you've got to go back to the Supreme Court of Canada for some of their strange judgments, I'll tell you, too. Odd judgments, indeed, that nobody can understand. Listen, that was quite interesting this morning. You're running again in November?
Mm-hmm, as far as I know.
Who's going to be in the slate with you? Marty Zlotnick?
I don't think Marty's going to run again.
He's not going to run again.
I don't think so.
You don't have a candidate for mayor up your sleeve if you check it out.
We have a surprise one. We're going to draft Jack Webster.
Hooray!
Jack Webster for mayor.
My thanks very much to May Brown. Very pleasant session this morning. What a change from Harry Rankin and Company. And Marguerite Ford. I'll be back after the break. My very special thanks to Norman Sedaway of Hollywood, to Doug Achilles-Heel, Deputy Minister of Information Programs, for that magnificent True to Life script which we presented to you this morning. I'm sorry I was such a pompous ass, but there are some days when I just can't really avoid being myself. My thanks to May Brown and Marguerite Ford. I'll be back tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely.